We are stewards of our investors' capital, and so we see ourselves as being the trusted guides of those investors, and we are really committed to educating our investors and maintaining high levels of transparency with them, because we see that there are a lot of firms where you invest capital in a VC firm and you might hear from them once a year via email, maybe not until there's an exit, right, for a few years, so depending on the firm. And so, you know, we maintain a high level of transparency with our investors and communication.
Welcome to Business Ninjas, brought to you by WriteForMe, where you'll hear from business leaders who are out there growing their business and slaying it every day. Learn from the masters. Let's get started.
Hi, and welcome to another episode of Business Ninjas. I'm here today with Olivia Gaudree, partner and vice president of operations at Fuel Venture Capital. Olivia, how are you doing today?
Great. Thank you so much for having me on here, Andrew. This is a true pleasure.
My distinct pleasure. Appreciate you spending some time with us on Business Ninjas. Please tell us a little bit about yourself and about Fuel Venture Capital.
Yeah, sure. So let me first talk a little bit about my background. I'm actually going to start. It's just like those movies where they start all the way back from when you were born. I'm going to do a similar thing, but try to keep it a little more brief than that. So, I was born into a very entrepreneurial family. Both of my parents are run their own small family business that they've been running for 30 years. And so at a young age, I really witnessed that mentality of building a business from scratch. And so it sort of fueled my interest in self-starter types who sort of have an idea and run with that vision and work really hard to realize them. And so I knew from a young age that I wanted to do something in business. I wasn't quite sure which avenue to go down, and that's a very broad field. And so I started actually in high school doing internships, my summers of those high schools and sometimes during the school years. And that sort of helped me to narrow down my field of interest. And so one of those internships was at a hedge fund. Another was at another local firm related to finance. So that was a great experience for me and sort of focused me in on the finance track. And so that's what I went and studied in college for, was a degree in finance at FSU. And so after I graduated, one of the connections I made was with an individual named Maggie Vo. And Maggie had started working at a firm called Fuel Venture Capital. And so she reached out to me. We had stayed connected throughout the years, and she said that there was an internship position available. And so, you know, at the time I was looking at full-time positions. And so an internship, I was like, do I want to take an internship position? But I just knew that breaking into venture capital, there's many traditional routes, but if you go the traditional route, you're looking at spending 5, 10, 15 years building your expertise and then trying to break into VC. And so, of course, when I saw this opportunity, I just jumped at it and ran with it. And so I've been a part of Fuel Venture Capital for the past 5, now almost 6 years. And my position has changed throughout my course at Fuel. So who we are, we're Fuel Venture Capital. We are a venture capital firm located in South Florida. However, we have boots on the ground all over the world and portfolio companies and LP base global. And so I've been part of Fuel. And as I've been with Fuel, I started off on the investments team side and worked in the investments team for the past 4 years. And so I was directly underneath Maggie Vo, the chief investment officer, and worked my way up as starting as a junior analyst and ultimately as a senior analyst before making a transition into the operations team. And so for the past, I guess it would be a year and a half now, almost a year and a half, I've been in the operations team, which is sort of, I like to view it as the catch-all phrase for a lot of different job functions at most firms, right? And the same is said at Fuel. So I work a little bit with investor relations, reporting, investor reporting, all of that. I work with our third-party partners. I work with our compliance officer. So a lot of compliance, a lot of legal, a lot of investor relations, speaking directly with our investors and reporting out. And because I had that cross training in the investments team, I'm still very involved with the due diligence process of the companies that make their way through our firm. So of course, having my first 4 years there, I have a very solid grasp of all things investments related at Fuel. And so that has benefited me well in this operations role. So that's where, that's a little bit about my path in Fuel. And just going back to Fuel, because I sort of started by explaining or started explaining Fuel and then switch back to myself. We have now four funds. We just launched our second flagship fund. We have a total AUM of around over now 500 million of assets under management. And collectively, right now, we have about 33 companies across those funds and are still, of course, deploying capital and raising capital in that second flagship fund. So that's just broad overview, but happy to take the conversation any way that that you want it to go.
Excellent. Well, to say that your role has evolved over time is a minor understatement. To go from internship to partner is quite a trajectory.
Yes.
What's the origin story of Fuel Venture Capital? When did they come to be?
Yeah, so Fuel was founded about 7 years ago now. It was launched 6 years ago by one of the general partners, the founding partner and managing director of Fuel, Jeff Ransdell. And Jeff served most of his life in the public sector, and he worked at Merrill Lynch. He was one of four that ran Merrill, reporting directly into the CEO. And he was in charge of America, the Americas, and Latin America. And so that's where he built out his network and spent 20 years, 20 plus years at Merrill prior to retiring. And he actually came out of retirement to start Fuel Venture Capital. He saw and, experienced the vibrancy of the tech scene in Miami, I think before a lot of people recognized that this was going to be a hub. This was back in 2017, right? So well before COVID spurred everybody to pay closer attention to Miami and see the breadth of opportunities that we have here, especially being closely, tied to Latin America and to Europe. And so he recognized this pretty early on. And, I think Jeff is one of those types who he can't sit still. He always has to be creating and pushing himself. And so he came out and started Fuel Venture Capital and became connected with Maggie. And so Maggie and Jeff are two of the general partners of the firm that have been building it for the past 7 years. And Jeff always knew that Miami was going to be the headquarters, and it's definitely served us well over the past 7 years. But that's just a little broad-based overview of Fuel.
Gotcha. Now, are your holdings tech-centric? I know you mentioned the...
Yes.
So give us a little sense of some of your holdings and the general... Let's say the general concept at Fuel Venture Capital and where your energies lie.
Yeah, sure. So yes, we do focus on tech-based companies. So they do have to have a tech component to them. And that's these days, right? Most companies have a tech component, but we really focus on tech rather than the hardware-focused companies because we like the asset-light companies. And of course, asset light companies are able to scale a lot faster, and your invested or our investors' invested dollars get put to work in ways that help the company scale faster, right? So that's always been a core focus for Fuel, and all the companies in our firm have a strong tech component, but that's pretty broad, right? So Flagship Fund One was a little more broad based. We focused on eight primary verticals, all the way from robotics to space tech companies to fintech. Mm-hmm. Fintech, we built a pretty solid position in, to IoT companies. And of course, a lot of our companies, leverage machine learning and algorithms. But, if we're talking about core technologies, that's sort of the focus that that first flagship fund had. And then our flagship fund two, we're focused more heavily on enterprise SaaS or IaaS. We're focused on marketplace companies. We're focused on fintech companies, and we're focused on sports and entertainment tech companies. So we've sort of built our niche in those four verticals, you know, through the relationships that we built with our investors and our broader network, mm-hmm. and the relationships that we built with our founders in that first flagship fund and the two subsequent funds. So that's sort of our focus in terms of technology. And yeah, that's our vision there.
Now, in terms of your investors, you know, it's a pretty tentative time, financially speaking. I think everybody in this country is sort of waiting for the other shoe to drop or wondering what's next. People do more research than ever to pull the trigger on these sorts of relationships. What differentiates you in the market? What makes Fuel Venture Capital stand out? How do you earn your investors' trust?
Yeah, and that's a great question. It's just like any industry, VC is a competitive marketplace, and there are a lot of different firms that offer different things. And our firm, there are certain core values that I think that we practice beyond what we just preach. And so some of those core values are, you know, we really have, our team has this corporate athlete mindset. So, you know, everything we do, we put in additional effort, just like the corporate athletes do, right? We're in Miami. So right in behind us, well, actually besides me, is the Miami Heat Arena, or whatever they renamed it to now. And, you know, there's one thing that actually one of the general partners pointed out to me one time that we went to a game, and he said, "Do you notice how before, I don't remember who the player was, but before the player shoots his shot, he looks at his ball and he dribbles it twice." And every player had something different, right? I mean, some player would just dribble it once, some players would just take a breath. But if you paid attention, there was one thing that every player did. They would stop and they would collect themselves. And then every time they would make that shot, right? So that corporate mindset of being in the game and dedicating your whole self and your whole mindset to working towards one initiative is definitely something that our entire team collectively has. And, you know, our obligation or our fiduciary is to our investors and to our founders, right? Both of them, we're a founder-focused, investor-driven firm. So we are constantly exerting the effort that's needed to achieve the successes that both our investors and our founders expect. So, you know, that's just something that I think is sort of like a mindset approach that we at Fuel have, and everybody who joins our team collectively shares, which is really important because in VC, you're dedicating a lot of time and energy to making sure that you make sound investment decisions and then help those companies to succeed and reach, you know, the objectives that you believe they can make, right? So it's sort of like this a philosophy that we always preach within the firm and then practice. And then, so the other thing is founder-focused, investor-driven. That is our core philosophy. Our obsession is to provide our founders with the resources that they need and require, leadership development, you know, sales team expansion, you know, when we talk about opening doors within our LP network, right? Providing them those resources to drive those companies again towards the shared vision. So, you know, the founder-focused nature is very close to us. And I'm sure the more VCs you talk to, that's where a lot of VCs have been putting a lot of their time and effort to differentiate themselves, is to build out those sort of like services, right, for their founders. And then on the investor side, we are stewards of our investors' capital. And so we see ourselves as being the trusted guides of those investors. And we are really committed to educating our investors and maintaining high levels of transparency with them, because we see that there are a lot of firms where you invest capital in a VC firm and you might hear from them once a year via email, maybe not until there's an exit, right, for a few years, so depending on the firm. And so, you know, we maintain a high level of transparency with our investors and communication, and we have built out certain technologies internally in an effort to increase the amount of communications we have. So we have quarterly newsletters, we have quarterly investor calls that we set up with our entire investor base and walk them through a presentation and then answer any questions that they may have. And then we post that on our investor portal that we have. We have, of course, any of the more general reporting, you know, financial statements, capital account statements are posted as well. So all of this is housed within what we call our Fuel LP portal. And so that's something that, you know, we do because Maggie and Jeff both have been on the public market side, and so have I in previous experiences. And so we understand the mindset of the investor, and we try to make sure that Fuel is aligned with providing our investors with best in class, not just services, but, you know, making sure that we have that commitment to transparency and education. So, you know, those are a few things that we really focus on, the founder-focused nature, investor-driven, and just the internal nature of sort of having that corporate athlete mindset. Those are big things for us. And then, you know, one other thing I'd probably say is our diversity. Our team is very diverse. I think Jeff may be the only person who is a white male who was born and raised in America. The rest of our team, you know, does have elements of diversity, right? Maggie Vo is from Vietnam. We have team members from Latin America, from Europe. So we're a very diverse team. And we view that as a power of ours, right? We bring a lot of different thought processes to the table. That just serves to better benefit both our investors and our founders.
Absolutely. You know, to your previous comment, communication is paramount in any relationship. The idea that that someone would trust you enough to invest a substantial amount of money and then have deafening silence for long periods of time.
Right.
Pretty hard to fathom. I do hear that is the case more often than not. So I applaud your approach.
Right.
And in terms of having diversity, multiple perspectives at the table can only advance, you know, your cause. So.
Completely. You invest in what you know, right? So when you have the same group of people, whatever background those people are, if you have the same group of people, they're going to make similar investment decisions at the end of the day. So diversity always serves as a benefit.
Absolutely. Let's talk about the last couple of years. COVID has been an eye-opening time for most businesses. It certainly made them aware of how flexible or inflexible they were. Tell me about your ability to grow and sustain yourselves through such a challenging time.
Yeah, COVID was definitely an interesting time, as it was with everyone, right? Obviously, there was a lot of uncertainty, and uncertainty is never a good thing in both the public and the private markets, right? Especially when it comes to one of the three things. Jeff always says there's three things that people hold closest to them. It's their faith, their family, and their health. Or he says their faith, their family, their health, and their wealth. That's it. And so, you know, obviously one of those things during COVID, well, actually two of those things were being tested, right? Your health and your family. And so a lot of people were sort of moving internally and sort of reassessing their situations. And so for us, it was interesting because, you know, in terms of our communications with our investor base, we actually ramped that up because we find during times of turbulence, it's best to stay hyper communicative. And this goes back to the point we were just talking about, right? And so we actually increased our communication cadence both with our investors and with our founders. And so, you know, from that perspective, we were externally communicating a lot more Internally, we were actually able to get a lot of things done internally and operationally. We actually went through a rebrand during that time. We built out some of the tech that I alluded to earlier. And so because we weren't going to as many external events, or having, you know, founders, investors fly in to come see us at our office, that afforded us the time to focus on things more internally and sort of prepared us really well for the next few years and even right now. And so it actually, it was a very successful time period for Fuel from that perspective, the internal, the operational perspective. As far as our portfolio goes, of course, like I said before, we invest in tech companies. And so these companies were less exposed to the difficulties that the lack of movement of people caused, right? Mm-hmm. And since a lot of these products or services are digital, they actually accelerated during this time. So of course, you know, no portfolio is completely immune. So there were a few companies that did suffer from the lack of movement of people, but the majority of our company, going back to our thesis of investing in tech companies, actually benefited during COVID from that like digital transformation. So it was, you know, I think it was obviously there was a lot of concern for us, for our investors' health, for our founders' health, and we combated that by being more communicative, which actually allowed us to form a closer relationship with our investors and our founders. And, you know, internally, we sort of hunkered down and were able to get a lot of things done that we wouldn't probably otherwise have had the time to do, or we would have, but it would have taken longer, right? So this sort of afforded us the chance to lock ourselves in the room and just focus on a few key initiatives that we were able to get done. So, and definitely an interesting time, but in the end, it we were able to get a lot done during that time period, I would say.
Excellent. And with such a tech heavy portfolio, was the supply chain crisis, did it impact you heavily in any way?
Yeah, so I mean, it definitely impacted some of our companies that do have some hardware tech components, such as we have a space tech company, and they had to figure out some supply chain difficulties and were able to figure it out in the end. But basically, it made all of the companies that had any hardware components or you know, anything to do with the shipping of goods, right? They suffered, right? Just like every other company. But what it caused them to do is just to have to pivot and figure out alternative solutions, figure out alternative manufacturers to help them work through that time period. And everyone was in the same position, but overall, most of our companies weren't in that situation because they were purely software based, right? So, you know, there were a few, but it was isolated to those few companies.
Excellent. Well, let's switch gears for a second. What role has content played in the growth of Fuel Venture Capital?
Yeah, it's definitely, content has definitely played a pretty large role for us here at Fuel. So we work with the Tag Experience, and we've been working with the Tag Experience ever since we founded the firm. And they actually work with us out of our office. And so we're side by side with them every day. And they really helped us to build our brand, and branding is really important for us here at Fuel. Having a strong social media presence not only serves to benefit our firm, but also benefit our portfolio companies, because we push a lot of portfolio company news and content out through our own social media channels. And so, you know, the social media side has definitely played a pretty large role, along with helping to build our position in the Miami tech ecosystem. That's been equally as important, because what do people go to these days, right? They Google you, right? They look at your website and they look at social media now. And of course, in the business world, they look at LinkedIn. So you have to have those social presences to compete in the workplace. No investor likes to look up your name and find no profile, right? That's not a good thing. You want this balance of, I would say, not being too open, right, with your social life, but with your business life. People want to see that reported or documented on these different media channels. And so it's always been a focus of the firm, and our general partners recognize the power of those social channels. And so we definitely leveraged it individually as well as collectively in Fuel. And then, you know, we, like I alluded to at the beginning, we recently, or now it's not recently, now it's during COVID, we went through a rebrand. And so during that time, we focused a lot on sort of driving those views through our own website and making sure that there was one consolidated location that people could go to find all things Fuel. And so, yeah, I mean, content and communication has always been key for Fuel. You know, we do a lot of podcasts just like this. We fill out a lot of things for newspapers and research whenever reporters reach out to us. So we're very much a part of the community in terms of providing our own information that we collect and gather with the local and broader communities and see the value in that. So it's definitely been a focus of ours for sure.
Excellent. All right. Let's look down the road a year. What are some things you'd like to be celebrating personally and professionally?
That's a good question. You know, so much happens in 365 days. I think if I answered this question last year, this time, it would be completely different than what it is today. You know, this year has been, I think, very challenging in the public markets. And you've seen that trickle down into the private markets, which is something we mentioned, I think, before we went on this call. And so, you know, we have been working very hard internally to, just like during COVID, build certain things out to help us get to a next level as a firm. And so my goal this time next year is to see those things come to fruition and to keep expanding on them, which I know is a little vague, but it's just because we have a lot of things in work right now. But I would say that this year for us has been almost similar to COVID in the sense that we've had to sort of rethink certain processes, and work to improve those this year, which will allow us internally and Fuel and our portcos to reach the goals that we've set for ourselves. So this year has been very important. And so next year, you know, what I'm hoping is that we'll see a lot of those things work the way we expect them to work, right? Our focus is just making sure that those initiatives excelling by this time next year. That's our focus.
Excellent. Please tell us what's your URL? Where can people find Fuel Venture Capital and what social media outlets are you using these days as well?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So our website is just fuelventurecapital.com. And we primarily use Instagram pretty heavily. We're across most social media platforms, but I'd say the ones that we use most heavily are Instagram and LinkedIn. Those are our most active channels.
Excellent. Olivia Gaudree of Fuel Venture Capital, thank you so much for spending some time with us on Business Ninjas today. I wish you and yours all the best and continued success at Fuel Venture Capital.
Thank you so much, Andrew. This has been a pleasure.
Be well.